you look at the barrel of a gun, what are you going to do?
He grew up in gangland Boston. James Whitey Bulger, fabled Southie protector turned murderous FBI informant.
They cut off her toes, her fingers, and pulled all their teeth out. I mean, this was a pre-DNA era.
It was a 20-year affair. Whitey in bed with the FBI.
And the FBI ended up becoming part of the Bulger gang.
The New England Mafia would tumble.
20-count indictment, charging seven individuals, including Gennaro and Julio.
Countless lives were destroyed.
20 years ago, my life was changed. Now, I want justice.
And a one-star FBI agent would fall.
Well, from the very beginning, it's understood.
Did you ever ask him if they killed anyone?
Well, why would I do that?
Now, James Whitey Bulger is a 10 most wanted fugitive. And former FBI agent John Connolly faces trial on corruption charges. This is the story of the outlaw and the lawman, Whitey Bulger and the FBI. It was here in South Boston where Whitey Bulger first rose to infamy. If these streets could talk, they'd tell terrifying tales of bodies dumped down stairwells, ex-girlfriends stuffed in car trunks, gambling, loan sharking, drug deals, all under the averted gaze of the FBI. For the next half hour, we'll take a look at Whitey Bulger's criminal enterprise, the life of a man first arrested at the age of 13, who did hard time in Alcatraz, but was home in time for Boston's gangland heyday. Boston in the 1960s, it was all out gang warfare. The battle was over turf, control and protection of local businesses, loan sharking, gambling, the growing drug market. But mostly it was retaliation, an eye for an eye, as gangsters flipped allegiances, turned informant, or simply ratted each other out. By the mid-1970s, law enforcement had had enough. Their target, La Cosa Nostra, led in Boston by Gennaro Angiulo and his four brothers. It took almost 10 years to bring them down.
Yesterday, a federal grand jury sitting at Boston returned a 20-count indictment charging seven individuals, including Gennaro Angiulo, Victoria Nicolo Angiulo, consisting of multiple acts of murder, illegal gambling businesses, illegal loan sharking businesses. The defendants were arrested last
That
evening.
Was September 1983. Bill Weld was U.S. attorney, and his organized crime task force had struck gold. But it was a long time coming. And as we now know, nailing the Angiulos meant giving the Winter Hill Gang, namely James Whitey Bulger and Stephen the Rifleman Flemmy, a free ride. The two gangsters had become informants for the FBI, working with Agent John Connolly and his boss, John Morris, to wipe out Boston's Italian mafia. Boston Globe reporter Dick Lair, author of Black Mass, says FBI agent John Connolly, who grew up with Whitey Bulger, first approached Bulger about becoming an informant for the FBI in 1975, here at Wollaston Beach in Quincy. What happened that night?
Well, what happened was it was after dark in October of 1975, and they had arranged to meet here. And so John Connolly backed his car into a parking space along here and was waiting for Whitey Bulger. And after a bit, Whitey came up from behind the car and slipped into the passenger seat, and they began their conversation.
And what was it that John Connolly was hoping to get from Whitey Bulger?
He wanted to enlist Whitey's help as an informant to get underworld intelligence against the Boston Mafia so that the FBI could, begin building a case against Jerry and Julio's crime family. You have to remember back in the 1970s that the FBI had declared as its national priority that it go after the Italian Mafia.
In New England, the Italian Mafia included Godfather Raymond Patriarca Sr. of Providence, his son Raymond Jr., the North End's Gennaro Angiulo and his four brothers, their second-in-command Larry Zanino, and a cadre of wise guys that included reputed mobster Peter Lamoni, recently freed from prison after spending 30 years behind bars for a murder he did not commit.
I feel bitter. How else can I feel? They took half my life away from me.
It was actually gangland hitman Joseph the Animal Barboza who fingered Peter Lamoni, But that was business as usual back then, a game of survival. Snitch on someone else and save yourself, which is one of the reasons Whitey Bulger agreed to cooperate with the FBI.
And so what was in it for Whitey Bulger to cooperate?
Well, if you have the FBI working on your competition, it's of enormous value to Whitey Bulger. So from his perspective, it was a great business decision. But beyond that, as we know in Boston, it was much, you know, more than an informant situation where they're just passing information. I mean, the FBI ended up becoming part of the Bulger gang.
And the government believes that too. Former FBI agent John Connolly is expected to go to trial sometime before the end of the year, charged with 9 counts of racketeering and obstruction of justice. Boiled down, Connolly is accused of aiding and abetting Whitey Bulger, warning him that certain places were bugged, even letting Bulger and Fleming know in 1995 that they were about to be indicted, a warning that sent Bulger on the lam.
You strip away the legalese, and you're talking not about an FBI agent, but a member of Bulger's gang. And what we're talking about are the charges that, and again, this is a pattern over the years of agents like Connolly and his supervisor, John Morris, of running cover for the Bulger gang.
Connolly and Morris have said they were only following orders. Bring down La Cosa Nostra. And Connolly has said he convinced Bulger if he turned on the Angulos, they'd start turning on each other. Much like what happened with Joseph Barboza, the one who turned in Peter Lamoni. In 1972, Barboza gambled and turned again, testifying this time against Jerry Angulo before Congress.
Jerry Angulo has over $1.5 million out in the street in Shylock at 1%. This is $10 a thousand. He makes $250,000 a week.
After that, the FBI gave Barboza a new identity and relocated him to San Francisco. But on February 11, 1976, Barboza's luck ran out. He was gunned down in broad daylight as a mother and her 3 little girls looked on. But by then, says Dick Lair, things had quieted down in Boston, and there really wasn't that kind of animosity between Bulger's Winter Hill Gang and the Angulos. In fact, there was something of a brotherhood, or so the Angulos believed.
Little did the Angulos know that that brotherhood had been breached years earlier. That night here at Wollaston Beach, when Whitey Bulger first considered becoming a liaison, as he preferred to be called, for the FBI. Once the deal was done, the mob's business, slowly but surely, began to unravel. And then the nail in the coffin. The bugging of the Angulos' North End headquarters at 98 Prince Street.
Well, it was in the middle of the winter in 1981, and on a cold winter night, a couple of agents came down this street here. There was Ed Quinn, who was the case agent for the operation, and a female agent named Deborah Richards. And they were posing as a couple, coming from a restaurant perhaps, acting a little drunk. And they made their way across the street and went up a couple of doors towards 98 Prince Street, which is the Angulo's main office.
So the two of them come stumbling up here.
Yeah, you're Debbie and I'm Ed.
Yeah. they signal to the other guys.
Well, they scoot up into the steps here, uh-huh. Which is a recessed entry, and there was a signal to a locksmith who came from some other direction, and then they were at the mafia's door.
It took agents all night long to bug the place, installing batteries in the roof to power the microphones. At first, nothing worked. Finally, with dawn breaking, they had audio.
Did you know how he is beating himself up? Where the hell?
And what did they accomplish out of the bugging?
They brought down Jerry and Julio's crime family, which had been ruling the city for several decades using their own words.
And did they talk murder, drugs?
Everything.
What were they talking about?
They talked the whole racketeering enterprise, which ranges from murder to bookmaking.
It's incredible.
Clearly, the Angulos did not know their headquarters were bugged. Everything came tumbling out.
Well, he don't believe that they're taking down the agents in a week.
No way going down.
Wait, you know they're taking $100 buildings. You got 100 guys that spent $1,000. You know, Larry.
Whitey Bulger got partial credit for the Prince Street tip-off, but in truth, he was not involved. The FBI put his name on the list of informants at the last minute to build his credibility as a snitch.
There's a history of minimizing Bulger's criminality in order to make the deal palatable to the FBI. The ideal informant is like a bookie, a nonviolent criminal. Here you had a murderer and a crime boss.
A crime boss everyone feared, but one state police were out to get. In 1980, state police stumbled on Whitey Bulger's headquarters, a garage on Lancaster Street near the Old Garden. Around the same time the Angiulos' headquarters were about to be bugged by the FBI, the state police figured it was the perfect opportunity to drop a few bugs on Whitey and Stephen Fleming. Or so they thought. State police did not know Whitey Bulger was an informant for the FBI. All they knew was the guy was trouble.
And what they did is that there's a rooming house. It was once a rooming house across the street. They took a room, and for the next several months, they went up there, a team of state troopers, and were clicking away with their cameras to develop their investigation and their probable cause to do a bug over here. And they just had this wonderful photo album of Whitey, Stevie doing business here, mafia figures, the Angiulo brothers coming over for meetings, standing in the garage bays, talking. And it was, you know, a very rich investigative material.
And whatever happened with the evidence that the state police collected that was going on here?
Well, it all folded. I mean, it now stands as one of the big leaks and one of the big failures in the efforts to chase Whitey Bulger. Again, this is 1980. And what happened was, after these weeks and months of developing the probable cause to get a judge to approve a bug, the state troopers put the bugs in here, and Whitey and Fleming knew about them right away.
Somebody told them.
That's right.
Indeed, someone had told them, and authorities think that someone was FBI agent John Connolly. Meanwhile, even though Bulger had dodged a bullet, he abandoned Lancaster Street.
Now the Winter Hill Gang was looking for new digs to run their bookmaking and loan sharking deals. They wanted a place with a legitimate business as their facade. They found the perfect place, an old gas station being renovated into a liquor store. No matter, it belonged to someone else.
Julie Dommers is only now talking about what happened to her and her then-husband Stephen Rakes almost 20 years ago. That's when the couple bought an old gas station and spent 6 months and $100,000 turning it into a family-run liquor store. Their store, Stippo's, had only been open for a week. Julie, pregnant with their third child, was alone at the store. Stephen was home with their two other young children when Whitey Bulger, Stephen Fleming, and associate Kevin Weeks came knocking.
So these three guys knocked on your home door. They came in, and what did they say to Stephen Rakes?
They came into the kitchen and sat at the kitchen table and proposed a deal. The first deal was that he was going to be partners with us in the liquor store, because apparently some people had come to Whitey put together a contract to kill my husband, because supposedly the liquor store was a bad thing. And so Whitey came with a proposal to say that he'll be partners instead of killing him. So when my husband called me and said, we're going to have a partner, and I, of course, I'm safe and sound at the store, not knowing what was going on, was diligent, and we have no partners. Saying, no, we're not partners with anyone, especially not him. Why would we be partners with him? And he says, I'll call you back.
When Stephen Rakes called Julie back that night, there was a new deal. Bulger, Fleming, and Weeks were now the proprietors of Stippo's. Whitey handed Stephen Rakes $67,000 in cash. There was no negotiating.
And did Bulger and Fleming leave any doubt in your mind, in Stephen's mind, that if you didn't go along with the deal, what would it mean for you?
When Whitey and Fleming and Weeksy sat at my kitchen table, my youngest daughter was only 13 months at the time, teething, waddled, crawled over, and Whitey Bulger put her up on his lap and allowed my daughter to teethe on the barrel of a gun. And of course, the conversation, whatever was going on, stopped, and everyone observed that, and Whitey just went, huh, be too bad you won't see her grow up. So the picture was really clear that we would die, my children would die, there was going to be no mercy.
And no mercy there was. Bulger, Flemmy, and Weeks immediately moved into the store, changing its name to the South Boston Liquor Mart, running their illegal businesses from the back room.
So once this had happened, I mean, you're terrified, you're outraged at the same time. What did you do? Who did you tell?
We went to my uncle, who's a police detective, to see if there was anything that could be done. And my uncle ironically said, oh, I just happen to know an FBI agent who just moved back into South Boston, and I'll go and talk to him. And as it was, he went to John Connolly, the FBI agent, and told him our story. And my uncle came back with a message from John Connolly that said, unless we were willing to wear a wire, there's nothing he could do for us.
Wearing a wire was out of the question. 3 days later, Whitey Bulger summoned Stephen Rakes to the liquor store. Waving a pistol in his face, Bulger said, back off. We know you've gone to the FBI. And that's because FBI agent John Connolly had gone directly to Whitey Bulger.
This whole thing was almost 20 years ago.
Mm.
How do you feel about it now? What do you want to get out of this?
I'm going to get upset. 20 years ago, my life was changed. Now, I want people to know what happened, and I want justice. I want to be repaid for what was taken away from me. Not only was our lives threatened, but our livelihood was taken. Our whole being was threatened. We were lucky to survive it, and I think we should get back what was ours.
The old liquor store is still there, closed now, and Julie is fighting in court to get it back. As for John Connolly, Julie says he should pay for what he did.
He was an officer of the law, and he didn't do a thing for me. In fact, he put me in danger by ignoring me. He may think he saved my life by maybe not having Whitey kill me, but I think he deserves whatever the law will uphold. His life should be ruined like mine was.
John Connolly and Whitey Bulger. It was an unlikely alliance. The outlaw and the lawman, who is now accused of being an outlaw himself. John Connolly will go to trial, not for what he did to Julie Dahmers, rather what he did for Whitey Bulger. 3 years ago, Connolly told us everything he did was sanctioned by the FBI at the highest level.
The bottom line is our mission was to take out a mafia family, and we accomplished it.
Mm-hmm.
We took out 42 members and associate mm-hmm. members, all of whom I would guess have killed at least five people, directly or indirectly. So you're talking about people who have killed maybe 200 people, and we took them out,
okay,
using a gang of two. If Bulger and Flemmy were hit by lightning, there was no Winter Hill Gang.
I think that's a lot of creative math. You always hear that line, the gang of two. Well, in 1990, there was a big drug bust of the Bulger drug gang, and their 50 people were indicted. They have a lot of people in the network.
No surprise, that's not the only place where Connolly's version of events differs. He also claims he was not the one who tipped Bulger and Flemmy that they were about to be indicted in 1995. Saying he hadn't talked to Bulger for a year before that.
When was the last time you had direct contact with Whitey Bulger?
I'd say I had contact with him a good year before he was indicted at the behest of the FBI.
So in 94 sometime?
That would be a good guess, mm-hmm. about 94.
And do you have any idea where he is now?
No, I do not.
But back then, before he was indicted, John Connolly had a lot to say, admitting the FBI sanctioned some of Bulger's criminal enterprises in exchange for intelligence on the Angulos. Bulger's partner Stephen Flemmy testified in court that the FBI condoned anything short of murder. Connolly says otherwise.
I don't agree with Flemmy's assertion mm-hmm. that he had the right to do anything but murder. They had the right to conduct a gambling and a loan sharking business and collect rent from bookmakers with no violence. Mm-hmm. From the very beginning, it's understood.
Did you ever ask him if they killed anybody?
Well, why would I do that? He was a source. I mean, the top echelon criminal informant program, the reason that a lot of these, they're having difficulty with this right now is it's in conflict with the Attorney General guidelines. It doesn't make any sense. And that's one thing that has emerged from these hearings. The top echelon criminal informant program was geared towards developing top echelon mobsters, primarily mafia members, who by definition have all killed at least once.
Whitey Bulger was a source for the FBI and supposedly a source of comfort for South Boston residents. A good guy gangster who regularly looked out for his own and refused to deal drugs. A fabled image that's long since faded.
I think he's a killer and a psychopath, and I think the most durable and corrosive myth of all was that he was Southeast protector and strong-arming anyone who was hoping to deal drugs in South Boston. I mean, this notion of Whitey Bulger as an anti-drug crime boss is laughable at this point and sad.
The FBI now agrees. Whitey Bulger has been on the 10 most wanted list since 1999, with a laundry list of charges and links to 18 murders, including that of Hi-Li executive Roger Wheeler, who was gunned down in 1980 after discovering Whitey and gang were skimming his profits.
This is just not a street corner neighborhood gang. I mean, they had reach, they had their hands in on, a major U.S. corporation, Hi-Li company, and were skimming, estimates are at the time over $1 million a year.
Meanwhile, Stephen Flemmy and Kevin Weeks are in jail. Flemmy has cooperated with authorities in return for a more lenient sentence, 10 years on charges of extorting bookies and obstruction of justice, although he still faces life if convicted on up to 10 murders. As for Kevin Weeks, he's the one who reportedly told police where some of the bodies from the Bulger gang's long crime spree were buried, leading authorities to a Dorchester location one freezing cold day in January of 2000, where they found the bodies of Deborah Hussey, John McIntyre, and Arthur Bucky Barrett, all believed murdered by Bulger and Flemmy in the early 1980s. Police also dug in several Quincy locations, trying to locate the body of Deborah Davis, a one-time Flemmy girlfriend who disappeared in 1981. After months of frustrating starts and stops, with Davis's four brothers looking on, Deborah Davis's remains were found, buried in full view of a condo where Bulger once lived.
And it doesn't get any worse than this. I mean, one of the reasons it took the authorities so long to identify that it was Davis, I mean, they cut off her toes, her fingers, and pulled all their teeth out. I mean, this was a pre-DNA era. And so Stevie and Whitey thinking, you do that and no one will ever know.
It's hard to fathom that the FBI could know of and condone such actions. But former agent John Connolly's boss at the time, Boston FBI Chief John Morris, has admitted the FBI got way too close to Whitey. Morris, who got immunity to testify in federal court, even admitted he took money from Whitey.
It was an act of corruption. He was a corrupt, I believe the guy was the most corrupt agent in the history of the FBI.
There's no question Morris was in it with John Connolly. I mean, the two of them were enablers for Whitey and Stevie.
While John Connolly denies ever getting kickbacks from Bulger or Flemmy, he appeared to live beyond his means, turning this South Boston townhouse into two condos, and later building this Georgian mansion in Linfield. But now, as John Connolly's day in court approaches, the only important question remaining is, where is Whitey?
He's not your average criminal. He's very bright. He's very disciplined. And I would think that he has the discipline to lay low.
He's very smart and very disciplined. He's also not a very social person, which these are all things that work in his favor for staying out there in the fugitive life. He's not like a lot of people from a neighborhood who need to have yes people around and all that. He's very comfortable by himself.
Although he is thought to be traveling with longtime companion Catherine Grieg. In fact, her monthly hair dye job almost got them caught in Southern California in January of 2000. Now, though, Whitey's whereabouts are anyone's guess. There's the theory that he's fled the country, the theory that he's completely changed identities, and the theory, held by many, that he's dead. That might explain why no one has come forward to claim the FBI's $1 million reward for anyone with information leading directly to the arrest of James Whitey Bulger.
Whitey Bulger is 72 now. He's been on the FBI's 10 most wanted list for 2 years. The odds of his staying on the run, though, are not good. Over 95% of the FBI's 10 most wanted fugitives have been caught in the 50-year history of the list. On the other hand, when it comes to the FBI, the odds have always been in favor of Whitey Bulger. I'm Emily Rooney. Good night.